Hi everybody, thanks for downloading and listening to this next episode of the Colonial Podcast. I just wanted to put a little note in before I start the podcast. My next guest, really interesting guy, great to have him on, but he was recording and then coming through to me from a backpackers in South America, so what you're going to get is a lot of background noise. Really difficult for me to edit a lot of that out, so hopefully that doesn't affect your enjoyment of the episode. It turned out really well, I thought, and great guy to speak to, and we had some good laughs. So hopefully you enjoy the episode, and I'll catch you guys next time. And also, the intro song is by that great funk band, The Gap Band. So yeah, enjoy. I'll speak to you guys soon. Welcome everybody to the next episode of the Colonial Podcast with me, Ewan, your host, and I'm joined today by a gentleman that I met on Twitter. He's somebody that I've actually kind of just met recently via Twitter, a guy with quite an interesting Twitter page, and somebody who is of interest to me because obviously that on this podcast what I try to do is just get in touch with other Celtic supporters who are maybe, you know, in strange parts of the world or are far away from Parkhead like myself. So without further ado, I'm delighted to be joined by Jonny Clifford. Jonny, tell us what your current location is, mate. Where are you on your intrepid travels?
How are you doing, Ewan? Thanks very much for having me on. I'm currently in Viña del Mar, which is in central Chile in South America.
Wow, awesome. That's
so a bit nearly as far away from Parkhead as you are, but not quite.
No, well, it's still pretty far away. Now, I should probably just get the background as to, you know, how I got you on the podcast, because Jonny, he follows me and he's been listening to the podcast. And I always try and look at the people that follow me, and you know, I noticed that he had quite an interesting Twitter page going on, obviously travelling through South America and stuff, and I thought, oh, I'll maybe chat to this guy. But it actually turns out that you know some of the boys from the Smell the Glove podcast. You know Chris, and you've actually met Chris, who was on the last episode. So how did that happen, mate?
I was at the Celtic Philly Fela 2 years ago. And honestly, it's probably like the best Celtic weekend I think I've ever had, including all games I've been to. It was absolutely brilliant. I can't recommend anybody enough listening to this to go along if you're close or if you're not so close. I came up from Mexico at the time, and it was just a brilliant weekend. It was 3 days. I can barely remember much of it, but I won't forget much of it either, to be honest. It was it's just a really good weekend. I met Chris, met Dr. J, Mick Graham from Beyond the Waves. I saw Paul Larkins, not even at Celtic, the Asterix Years. Yes, we saw that live. It was like the first screening in the States, I think it was. Brilliant. Met Jungle Paul from Toronto, loads of the Philly boys as well. Seamus that organised the event, and Tim, does a few of the Rebel songs and that. It was just a brilliant weekend. Absolutely fantastic.
I'm jealous. I'm probably not alone when I say I'm jealous. It's something that I've been wanting to try and get away to. I'm going to try and use some form of bribery on my missus to get over there. But yeah, it was funny when you mentioned that you knew Chris, because I thought, how small was the Celtic world? You know, like I obviously had never met you, And the first thing you tell me is that you know Chris and the guys from Smell the Glove. So it's the Celtic world is a small one sometimes. It really is.
It's so strange. Like somewhere by yourself. Like I'd been speaking to Chris and Dr. J and Paul for weeks before even being at the Failure, and it's probably one of the few things in life where you can, you know, you cannot actually meet somebody face to face, but as soon as you get there, as soon as you put a face to the name, you know, it's as if you've been pals for years. Like, right. So it's, right. You know, it's a really, really, really nice sentiment.
Yeah, it's interesting going on to the, you know, obviously yourself, you've been, so you're in Chile just now, and you've been in South America for 5 or 6 years. Did you say you've been out there for a while, eh?
Yeah, I used to work as a holiday rep for Thompson Holidays. As soon as I left school, I got straight to the repping, and I went and did all, like, you know, the party places in Europe. So I was in Zante in Greece for 2 years, and then I was in Ibiza in Spain for 2 years, and in the winters I was doing the ski seasons.
Right.
And then they said to me, like, at the end of one winter, oh, there's a space in Cancun, would you want to go and check that out? It was an absolute no-brainer, and I just fell in love with Mexico, the people, you know, just the way of life in Latin America is absolutely amazing, and I've not left since, and that was 3 years ago.
Plus, I bet there's some, Paulie D was saying your only occupation is going around South America shagging all the hot women, but, you know, you get an opportunity now to clear the record, mate.
Well, no, I mean, an old man could be listening to this podcast, so I'd just like to strike the record clean and reiterate that I've spent the last 3 years checking out cultural museums.
Of course.
Good
young Tim Wood.
Oh, yeah, 25-year-old single guy in South America.
No, I'm sure you don't get any attention as well. You know, you're probably one of the only white face in the crowd, so I'm sure you don't stand out.
Well, That's the funny thing, actually, because, you know, you go up Sucky Hall Street and you say, all right, hen, to a girl in a dress, and be lucky if you don't get a Malky. But in South America, I'm like this exotic, well, I wouldn't say I'm exotic, but like in their eyes, you know, because you're foreign, yeah. you get a lot more attention. So definitely the tables have turned.
It's interesting that when I lived in Dublin, All the Irish guys that I used to work with were noising me up, saying, "Oh, you won't have any problems out there with your Scottish accent." But you know, when you go to these Latin American countries, if you've got fair skin and fair hair and whatever, you know, you stand out. But I'm really glad I got you on the podcast, and we're going to go into a couple of the games that have just passed there. I just missed the kind of half of the last game, so you can fill us in on the Ross County. But good to get you on, because it's always of interest to me, and I'm sure it's of interest to a lot of other, you know, Celtic supporters out there, to find out, you know, where we all are in the world and how we keep up to date with Celtic, no matter where you are in the world. You know, the social media and podcasts and just being able to actually listen to the homeboys and guys like that, it really gives you a real connection. It doesn't matter where you are in the world, you know, you, as soon as you listen to one, you feel like you're back home, you know.
Definitely, yeah, definitely. No, it's a privilege to be part of it, so thanks again for having me on.
Oh, no worries, mate, no worries. I'll have anybody on the podcast, as long as they've got, you know, passion for the club and they've got a bit of chat, that's cool, you know. I'm not proud, but so we, I guess, probably talk about the Sevco game quickly. It's been kind of covered off, but I just wondered, what did you make, like, on the lead up to the game, how were you feeling about playing them beforehand? Were you in any way anxious at all? Like, normally, as we, you know, in the old days when we used to play the old firm and invented commas, you know, you'd always have a kind of pre-match nerves, but did you have any worries or concerns before that game against Sevco?
No, certainly in the lead up to it, I was very nervous, you know, considering how dire we'd been at hand in the last couple of fixtures I can even remember being there. Uh-huh. And you know, you listen to all the, I don't like to listen to too much of the mainstream media, but obviously you get it chucked in your throat pretty much at every corner you turn. So you're hearing, you know, all these idiots online saying about how they're a stronger team and they're tighter at the back. So, but before the game, I would say I was a lot more apprehensive. Definitely, probably, well, you'd go as far to say the most apprehensive I've been in any inverted commas or Celtic Sevco game in their history. I don't think I'd been as nervous before, but right. At the end of it, like, when you look back on it, it's probably the most convincing 1-0 I've seen in my history of being a Celtic fan.
That's it.
And like, they had all the luck in the world. You know, their goalkeeper played out of his skin, shocking refereeing, and still, you know, we just pretty much show their dominance in Scottish football.
Yeah, yeah. And it's interesting because, I was thinking about this yesterday and how, you know, like, if you look at the league and how it is and stuff and where we're sitting with Rangers, you know, obviously they came up last year and they've had some investment from Dave King. And I think we were all kind of watching that to see what would transpire, who they would sign, how they would get on. And I think as the season goes on, and I think, after we play them at Ibrox as well, I really think what you're going to see is just... The layers are going to get peeled away from them, you know. We're going to see them. They're going to have to sit back and take stock, because so far from Rangers, it's been a lot of kind of hot air and big noises coming from Joey Barton and you know, the press that's been going out. And before the semi final there, it was very quiet. You know, you only had a couple of players do the standard pre match kind of press release. And I think if we can go. I believe we're going to beat them at Ibrox, and I believe we'll beat them fairly convincingly. And I think after that, you might see a few of them getting put back in their box, because that's already happening in the mainstream media. You could hear, like, straight after the games, the BBC were saying, "Oh, the top two teams in Scotland will be playing in the final," you know, and that will not sit well with them. As soon as I think it's Chris McLaughlin and the guy in BBC Sports Sound said the top two teams will be playing in the semi-final, and I was like, they're going to go nuts when they hear that, you know.
It was Liam McLeod. He's a big Aberdeen fan as well.
Liam McLeod, there you go.
But I know. I mean, you'd like to think so, but you know, grew up in Glasgow better than most what they're like, and I just think it's that. It's that mentality, you know, that union mentality, and that just sort of we're better than everybody else, and only our opinion matters. That you know,
it's the bully boy.
You would need to give them another bat. Exactly, exactly. But no, I think the next game will prove vital. But like I say, we're, in my opinion, and most realistic football fans. You know, we're fucking light years ahead of them. You know, they drew one all at home at St Johnstone today, which was a big game for them. You know, you think the crowd would be, and I'm sure the crowd would be in the game. I'm not listening to any of the commentary, any of the post match analysis from their game.
Yeah.
But I'm sure the crowd would have been getting on their back if they can't fucking beat St Johnstone at home.
And this is the thing, we've had all this chat about the gap, and I was thinking about it in terms of, like, if you look at it as two objects, right? So you've got a car, let's say car A is sitting on the road in front and it's accelerating. It's constantly, you know, its speed is increasing constantly. And then you've got car B behind it, who's basically maintaining its speed or decreasing. That gap is getting bigger all the time. So it's not that the gap even is staying the same. It's definitely not narrowed. It's increasing as the months and, you know, as time goes by. That gap, I mean, I actually tweeted out, we're light years ahead of them. You know, Graham Souness says 5. I'd say more than that, because all the noises coming out of kind of social media and anybody who's done any investigating into Rangers is that financially they really don't have too much to rely on at the moment. So I don't think it's going to be a good season for them, because as you say, their expectations are that they're going to finish. I don't know what they think they're going to do. If when they came in, they said they were going to win it, and now they're like talking about second. I actually think they should be happy to finish in the top 5. If I was there,
I'd agree. I mean, like, definitely, you've got to feel for them. Is not the expression I'm trying to use. I'm just trying to think of a better way of analysing. Like, if you look at their three main signings this season. So they've got Crankyar, who hurt himself in training out for the rest of the season. You've got Barton. I don't even need to fucking say anything about his situation.
No.
And then Garner, I think, has Garner even scored more than 3 goals the whole season? No, if that?
Yeah.
You know, and like they were their three marquee signings.
Yeah.
And all three of them flattered to deceive.
Yeah.
So it's like the small budget they've got for decent players, if you could even bracket those three individuals as decent players, I certainly wouldn't. Yeah, but you know, that's the best they're going to get, and even those three fail to perform for them. So.
Well, the recruitment has been bad. It's been mentioned already. I think Joe Garner's only scored, I think his record before he came up to Rangers was he's only scored 4 goals in a season or something. So, it's not going to get any better for them. And in that game, they could have got lucky, I think. And I picked up on this in the Borussia Mönchengladbach game with Celtic. If we were a little more disciplined in the final, not even going to say the final third, I think in the final quarter, if such a thing can be said, I actually thought that we were a little bit wasteful. Celtic were actually, even though we dominated that game, and we did dominate it, what I saw was that when there was a man free, we were trying to shoot the ball. So we were taking, like, you know, hopeful shots when we should have been looking for the pass, and then the rest of the time their keeper just saved it. So they were kind of lucky, really. And to come away saying that there's any kind of gap, it's not a gap. It's a huge canyon. You know,
it's a fucking quarry or something like that.
We're galaxies past them. So yeah, I won't draw on the Sevco game too much because everybody's talked about it. But I thought Yozo was great. I think Dembele is now becoming indispensable. You know, if he keeps on going the way he's going, we're looking at a player that we just can't drop him. Forrest was okay, I thought. He wasn't amazing, and I think maybe his form is dipping a little bit. I was disappointed to see Bitton play and not Henderson, and I was justified in saying that we should have dropped him because he was absolutely rank rotten in the Sevco game. He was doing the same thing or worse.
Especially after his performance in the game prior against Borussia as well, I would have sort of looked at his team sheet twice if he wasn't in it. He didn't warrant a place for me, and yeah, like you say, I echo what you said. He proved that it was pretty poor performance from him.
Yeah, it wasn't great, and I think I was watching Forrest, and he had a tidy game. He put some passes, and he was doing his usual. You know, he does work harder than he used to under anybody else. He's definitely working hard for Brendan. But there was one occasion, I think it was around about the 54-minute mark. And if people don't believe me, they can go and watch the replay if you've got that. Go to the 54-minute mark. You will see James Forrest standing with the ball, and he's got one defender in front of him, and acres of space behind, so if he beats the man, he's running in, he's basically running in on goal, or he's putting in a brilliant cross or a brilliant through ball, and he literally stops and holds the ball. And when I was looking at it, I was like, wait, just go, you know, you've got the pace, you can beat him. And what he was doing, he was waiting for Lustig to come up, so that's what happened. He waited and waited and waited, gave the ball to Lustig, who then ran into the defender and kind of fell over. I think Lustig tried to like dribble or something, and Lustig can't really dribble. I mean, he's not known for his dribbling. So that, you know, for me, I want to see Forrest not even. I think hesitancy can harm any side, but certainly the attacking players. If you start to hesitate and not take that instinctive shot or move, it can harm us. And I think that's why when I saw Paddy Roberts on today against Ross County, I was like, nice, you know, that's what we need to be doing. Excuse me, I've got a phone call coming in.
What is?
As you can hear. And we're back. Yeah, sorry, I've got, for some reason my dogs had a wee moment to themselves there. I just got the kick in the head to keep the dogs quiet. I don't know what's going on with them. So I guess my main point was, you know, I don't want to be critical when we were quite clearly the better side, but I just, some things I've just noticed, a wee bit of hesitancy, like with Griffiths, you know, his shot, normally when you see Griffiths, he'll just try and put it in the corner, and he tried to chip the keeper, and it was a bit, so, just I think a little bit of hesitancy creeping in, and people not firing instinctively, although I thought Dembele still played really well. We could see the shots he was taking them first time, whereas maybe Sinclair and Griffiths hesitating a wee bit, and Forrest hesitating a wee bit to beat his man and cut inside quickly like he's really good at doing. So but yeah,
I think Sinclair as well would only just scrape pass marks for me. I think when you compare it to his other performances this season, it wasn't quite up to his usual standard, but I still felt, you know, if it, like, not, I hate to say this, I hate to go extra time around like that. Obviously, I'd rather get the job done in 90 minutes, but I wouldn't have as much fear or nervousness if it had been an extra 30 minutes. I think we played them off the park the whole game, and it would have just been even another repeat of that if it had gone an extra half hour.
Hun scubbery, as the ball boys described it. Hun scubbery. I'm going to steal that from them. A bit of plagiarism. It was, you know, so easily. If Gilkes had been, if their goalkeeper had been off form, we would have pummeled him. I think that's probably where we'll leave that. Going out to the Ross County game today, played up at Ross County's ground, was quite good for me because it's an evening kickoff, which means I get to see it in the morning. And although it was on and I had the stream, I just couldn't watch it because I was busy. So I kind of caught bits of it. I didn't see the first goal. I saw the replay of the goal, and I saw Armstrong's goal. But what did you make of the game, Jonny? Because you watched the whole game. So just give me your take on it.
I mean, I managed to get most of it. The stream I had was pretty dire, to be honest. So especially the first half, it was sort of cutting in and cutting out.
Right.
But first of all, like, to take it from the top, the team, I was really happy with the team that Roger selected, because before the game I was sort of trying to predict my own team and I wanted to make a few changes. I never knew he would change the team as much. I think it was, I don't know the exact number, I'm sure someone will ken, I think it's like 7 or 8 changes for the last game in the starting lineup, which was pretty ballsy considering, you know, before he's been talking about how he likes to keep the momentum and that. So I was really, really happy with the lineup. Over the moon to see Henderson get a shout, a chance, to see Christie get a chance. Izaguirre as well, I thought he had a great game, but
brilliant.
I've got a bit of bias towards him anyway, or anyone that plays left back for Celtic, to be honest. So I did a wee bit of research before the game on some statistics, because I was a bit nervous about the result, but I got a lot of confidence when I looked at County's recent form. So they haven't actually won a game in 8 games. Well, now it's 9 games. The last time they picked up 3 points was on the 20th of August. They got pumped in the Highland Derby 4-0 two games ago. So their form leading up to the match was pretty poor. In the first half, I thought we controlled the game. Really, really good pressing for the front three, especially considering, you know, the three of them haven't played a first team game together and God knows how long. And then in the second half, maybe they took their foot off the gas a wee bit. Ross County came back into the game. But I think overall, you know, 4-0 probably flatters us a wee bit, but well-deserved games. Well-deserved of the 3 points.
That's good, mate. From what I can see, the game was kind of 50-50. We weren't really completely dominating it. I mean, we always looked the thing about Brendan Rodgers' side is this side that he's put together, we always look dangerous when we're attacking. And then, you know, again, it comes down to the final ball or the final shot. But from where I was watching it, and it's funny watching the games at those smaller stadiums because your viewing angle changes. You don't get so much of a top down view. It seems to be more of a kind of, you know, from the dugout view or lower in the stand. So you lose that perspective of players' positions. You've got to get used to watching those games, and I've not, you know, I don't follow the lower championship sides, and all these guys who go to those games will be used to, but I'm not used to watching a game lower down like that. So couldn't really see the overall layout, but you know, we looked as if we were going to go on and win it 1-0. I thought it was going to be a 1-0, and then right at the end I saw the reports. I saw Armstrong's goal, and then I saw that we scored another 2 and I was away from the game. But yeah, it actually turned out to be quite an important game given the Aberdeen defeat at Hamilton.
I know,
and then obviously Sevco drawn. That gives us, I mean, today's result is massive, but I think you're right. It does flatter the scoreline, definitely flatters us, because I think Ross County actually didn't play too badly.
No, they played well. I mean, you could tell Gardine was putting what he learnt at Barrowfield to good use, pretty much. I mean, he was for me the best player for them. But for me, the biggest focal point was Gordon. I'm not sure if you saw the Gordon incident. I kind of it was 15 or 20 minutes within the time, but he came out like he's done a couple of times this season and battered their centre forward. Oh. For me, he was lucky to stay on the pitch. Oof. If it had been at the other end of the park, I would have been absolutely raving. That it should have been a decision against the other way. So he was lucky to stay on, and Celtic had made all three subs by this stage as well. So if he'd have got sent off, which if it had been your man fucking brother Thompson for last week, he would have got a straight red. That's for sure. Actually, an interesting fact. I was looking at a bit of statistics before it came on. Do you know that Craig Gordon, before today, is our second highest booked player?
Is that right?
He's got the second most yellow cards in the whole Celtic squad.
Whoa.
And he's a fucking goalkeeper.
Fucking fun fact for the day, Jonny. I had no idea that was the case. I would never have. I mean, the Man City game was amazing because there was not a single booking, but I've not really been keeping track of. You know, we've not been. I mean, I don't think we've had a sending off. Our discipline seems pretty good in the Celtic side, so I've been pretty happy with it.
It's just the player you'd least expect to have poor discipline to be the player between the sticks.
Interesting, eh? But he does do it. I mean, I obviously watched the game. I think it was against, was it Dundee, when he came out and floored that boy. and it was like, what are you doing? And this was round about the time when Doris De Vries was still kind of, you know, and it was like, who are we going to pick? But yeah, Gordon's definitely he's gone in the right direction for me. He's got the jersey and he deserves it. I still think, and we'll talk about the transfer window, I guess, coming up. But so overall, you were quite pleased with the game. But you thought, so the last couple of goals I missed. What was that? I actually haven't seen Dembele's goal. What was it like?
Dembele's goal was, for me, it was all Paddy Roberts. He deserves all the credit. It's a bit, actually, you know, he's a great player. I'd probably go and say he's probably the most talented player we've got in terms of potential and talent. You know, he's really world class. But it's like Aidan McGeaney, like he's fucking frustrating, man. Like he'll skin the player once or twice, and then rather than get a decent boiling, he'll fucking skin them again. He'll go on the outside, the inside, and a lot of time it works and it looks fantastic, but it's just a little bit frustrating to watch. But anyway, it paid off this time. I think he skinned the defender twice or three times and put a brilliant ball in, and Dembele was cool as you like, side footed it right in the bottom corner. Fantastic. But yeah, I mean, Roberts played, I'm not sure who got man of the match, whether it was Roberts. For me, it would have been, I thought Armstrong was probably our best player. Like, I thought he bossed the midfield, played really well, but yeah. I'm not sure if Roberts got it, because I think he scored one and set up two or something like that. So maybe he got the man of the match.
Armstrong's actually, he's coming on to something. I said a few podcasts ago, you know, I haven't given up on him yet, and I think Brendan can get something out of him, because we know he's got, you know, when he was playing well for Dundee United, he was one of the hottest prospects in Scotland, certainly for his position. So yeah, I'm really glad that he's picking up. You know, I would actually have him in there ahead of Bitton or Henderson. I mean, for me, Bitton's done. He was done for me at the beginning of the season. Last season, I was finished with Bitton, but I think if Stuart Armstrong keeps this up, he's going to keep doing well. Here we go again. Hold on, I'll have to pause.
No worries. No worries.
So really good to see Armstrong playing well, and he took his goal brilliantly, and I just hope that continues, because you know, the more talent we've got in midfield right now, the better. But Dembele got a goal, and who else scored for goal number four, was it?
Sinclair got the last one.
Right.
It was well took, you know, he showed a lot of composure. He was in the right place at the right time, so to speak. Right. Or actually, no, I think, was it not? Did he score the third and
Dembele scored the
fourth? And the fourth.
Right.
I think, as I said,
I missed him. But I'll see the replays.
No, it was Sinclair scored the third and Dembele scored the last.
Right.
But for Sinclair's goal, you know, it was just, you know, it's good predator instinct. You can tell that he's you know, that he's played in the highest level.
Nice.
I think the ball came off the keeper, and he just in the right place at the right time. Really good spatial awareness and finished it well, top corner. That was a good goal.
Yeah, that's good from Sinclair, because we definitely need Sinclair. He's effectively a striker, or kind of, you know, second striker. So you know, you want him taking those chances. So that's good. Now I'm really pleased. As I said, when I was looking at the Ross County game, I thought it's not that big a deal, but actually, given the results previously, it leaves us in a really good position. I mean, if we can beat Aberdeen this weekend, that's and we get a result against Hearts, we're heading into Christmas with a massive advantage that I don't think we're going to get caught if it keeps going on.
Yeah, no, it's good how everything sort of worked in our favour today. The results were in the country.
So, I was thinking about how we've got, obviously, we're heading, the transfer window coming up in January. And I see James McCarthy was spotted at the semi-final. I wonder if they're keeping him in the background, and they've maybe got an agreement, because one of the reasons, or the rumour around James McCarthy not signing, was that he actually had an injury that he was having to work on. So I'm wondering if...
Oh, really?
Yeah, apparently that's one of the reasons that he had to go into rehab and get some physio done. So it'd be interesting to see who we pick up.
That'd be a great signing. Certainly, I think that position in the park is where we need to strengthen. For me, I'd say, same as yourself, Gomer. What the things you said in previous podcasts, I would be the happiest person if Celtic sold Beaton. I think at the moment he's definitely the weakest part of the team, or the part of the team that we could. That we should be strengthening. Obviously, if Armstrong comes into the game, but someone of McCarthy's caliber would be ideal.
Yeah. For me, I've said it already. I think we need to look at getting, because hopefully Colo Touré stays on. But if he does go away after next year, then I'd like us to get another centre back, and maybe, I don't know how Gamboa played. How did Gamboa do today, Jonny? Did you watch him in the game?
Yeah, he played well. I think he got caught a few times defending. Well, certainly from what I saw, but like you say, it's hard when you're watching it on a really low camera picture on an iPhone as well.
Yeah.
But it seemed like when he was getting caught, it was defending. But certainly going forward, his link-up play attacking was really good. I thought both wings played well, especially Izaguirre and Roberts linked up really well. And he was good going forward. He seems like he uses his pace. He's a bit like Forrest, just sort of runs at a defenders. But he definitely played better than he played against Barcelona. But you know, you look at that, he wasn't fucking defending against Messi, no. Neymar and Suarez tonight. No. So
no, I think that's you can't really judge him on that. It was
his birthday tonight as well, so I'm not sure if that had given him any extra.
Yep, he had his jelly and ice cream at his party and then went out and played. But it's interesting just thinking of, because obviously we've got Gamboa's got the pace, but maybe not the discipline. And Michael Lustig's got the discipline. He's a very good passer, and he can tackle, and I think he reads the game quite well. Other than Europe, where he just seems to switch off in Europe for some reason. But where Lustig doesn't have that pace, I think Gamboa does. So it'll be interesting to see how he develops as a player. Chris from Smell the Glove was saying he's watched them live, and he reckons he's extremely fast. I still haven't seen enough of him, but I hear that he's very, very quick. So I'll watch the replay and see how he is, because apparently he's rapid.
He had one instance. It was right towards the end when he was through. I think he had one or two defenders to beat, and he played a little bit of relaxed as he go past. It ended up not getting off, but he's better than Saidi Yanko, I suppose. But he's not. I felt the side of the ankle maybe didn't get enough of a chance. What he got the half wall game and one domestic game and one preseason game, and that was all Rodgers really gave him. But I mind when he played for Bolton and Lennon was the manager, he got Bolton's young player of the season. And also when he left Man United, all the Man United fans were being like, "Oh, what's going on here?" And yeah. I don't know, maybe he wasn't given enough of a chance. Maybe something
behind closed doors. It's a funny one, that one, because it's like, you know, when he came, they were all, Man United were like, "Oh, we've let one of our rare talents go." So, you know, they were supposedly pissed off about it. It's funny for me, you know, I really think that Rodgers saw something there that he didn't like. That's all I can put it down to. It must be, you know, he's the kind of person that will do that. Ben Rodgers thinks he's the kind of guy who just kind of players that he's not needed.
Yeah, he definitely seems like I'd agree, yeah.
So, tell us, where are you joining us from? Are you in a hall? Is it the internet room in the Backpackers? Is that where you are?
Aye, pretty much. I'm on I'm on the second floor of a hostel.
Right.
I've actually got a bit of a sticky situation tonight as well. Because I was meeting a lassie on for a date. Now, before you start, there's a terrible rumour going around that it was off a social media site, and I just want to echo that it wasn't. It was a natural meet. But
of course,
it turns out that she doesn't seem the same as she looks in her picture. So she's downstairs and now being taken care of by one of your compatriots from. I've been told it's the Shire in New Zealand.
Oh, that's it, yeah. That's it. That's where
Wata Wata, something like that.
That's it. Yeah, that's where all the hobbits live over here.
And a German guy that's in the same dorm as me. So I'm hoping that this podcast will make her leave. But looked at the window there and she's still down there. So
you get no sympathy from me, mate.
No, absolutely not. I just don't be going on any dating sites when you're steaming and swiping to the wrong way, because it'll come back and bite in the arse, which I'm about to find out whenever this finishes.
Thankfully, I never use the dating sites. I'm far too old for Tinder now. But yep, I guess it's a occupational hazard, like yourself. So are you? Where are you moving on to next? You're currently in Chile. You're moving into Argentina next. Is that right? Or
yeah, I'm going to Santiago, the capital, either tomorrow or Friday. And nice. There's two big games this weekend. There's Colo Colo, which are probably the most established team in Chile. You know, they've done best in the Libertadores, which is like the South American version of the Champions League. But there's also the two big teams in Santiago. There's two universities. There's La U, which are basically university, and there's La U Católica, which are a different university. They right. actually played last night in a derby.
South American defender Rangers signed Seb Rosenthal. Did he come from that? I think he signed from a club that sounded like University Católica. I remember Rangers signed a guy who basically cost him a fortune, got injured and never played. And he came, I think he came from that club side, but someone can correct me on that.
Aye, there.
Sorry, random fact.
No, it's good. I've been to a lot of games on my travels. Like, I started like with a backpack. I started in Panama, and I've done Panama, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia.
Nice.
And now in Chile. And for me, you know, Argentina's got the best reputation, and I can't wait to go to some of the games. They're obviously Boca and River, the famous ones.
Oh, yeah.
Got another team called Rosario Central.
Oh, yep. Okay.
And, they got to the semi-final of the South American Champions League last year. And their fans are like, absolutely mental. There's another Scotsman living in Argentina on Twitter. He put a video up a couple of days ago, and the atmosphere looks electric. So I'm looking forward to that. But
those games are
for me. In Colombia, it's so different compared to like the way games are policed in Scotland. You know, they encourage you to go along and you know, you go along with trumpets and massive drums and confettis and huge banners, and you know, the police don't give you any bother, whereas in Scotland, you know, they're just the few games I've been in the last couple of years are trying.
It's so
to intimidate young fans.
They're so narrow-minded in Scotland, yeah, it's not even funny. When I listen to the guys over there, you know, coming back from games and on the podcast talking about how they've got all this over the top security and police presence and everybody being stopped and stopped on trains and stopped in the car, and, you know, basically treated like, you know, second tier citizens and cattle. It's just, nothing changes in Scotland, you know. It's just like more of the same. You know, God forbid we should actually do something for the fans, especially the fans of one of our top sides. You know, you wouldn't want to make any allowances for us, so just keep us under the hammer.
It must be one of the only nations in the world with only nation in the world, like in general, where the fans are treated like criminals. I mean, you look at the model they've got in Germany, and you know how much a season ticket costs there, how you get free transport from the city centre to the stadium. You know, you can have a beer inside the stadium, you get looked after really well. Everyone's happy to be there. It's like a different sport.
Here, have a beer, guys. And you can have a smoke. Do you want a bud? There we go. We've got a couple of blondes. You know, like, it's one of those Carlsberg adverts. Just magic.
No, but definitely over here, I mean, anyone that's listening that gets a chance, you know, even if they go on holiday to Mexico or somewhere like that, always try and get to a local football game, because it's just, the atmosphere is absolutely incredible. It's like one big party. You've got loads of... Just loads of things to induce the atmosphere and make you enjoy it even more.
So let me ask you a question. I mean, you're out with your Celtic top on. How many people have recognised you so far and recognised the club?
Not as many as I'd like, to be honest with you. I get a lot more attention when I go out wearing my kilt than wearing my Celtic top. But a lot of people over here, or certainly, you know, the countries I've been in so far, their knowledge of Scottish football is pretty low, especially the first year we've been competing in the Champions League since 2012 or so, three or four seasons.
Yeah.
So we're not as well known as we were a few years ago, but I love to represent. Any football game I go to, I always wear my Celtic top.
Yeah, of course.
Apart from I went to the Lima Derby a couple of months ago, Alianza against La Universidad de Lima, and I didn't do my homework on the teams, and I went to the home section, but the away team, Universidad, and it was there like opening inverted commas, closing inverted commas, Old Firm, and I was wearing the fucking same colour as the opposition, so that was a bit of a bastard, to be honest. But other than that, it's always good. Always good to wear the hoops or the Everton eye.
So there must be you'd be doing a bit. There must be some talent on the pitch. I was listening to the By the Minute Celtic podcast, and he had it was Harry Brady. It was a Celtic Underground podcast. Sorry, I think I was listening to Harry Brady had some one of his mates over in South America, and he was saying there's quite a lot of young talent over there that have, you know, European national status, you know, and he was saying that, you know, there's a lot of talent in South America that hasn't been picked up. So you must be watching the games with some interest and seeing quite a few skillful players.
Absolutely. It's definitely the games I've been to have been a lot more all out attack, you know, none of this. I suppose it's different watching Celtic when every team you come up against tries to defend, but you know, both teams generally will have a go at each other. The football over here, the only thing, like, you know, I always try and wish, especially living in Mexico for so long, I always want a good Mexican player to play for Celtic. But if you look at a few of the South American players that have played in Champions County, Dundee's, and they had like fucking three Argentinian World Cup players in their squad in the early 2000s. But I mean, other than them, you look at players that play for Celtic, for example, Miku, that came through Barcelona, he played for Barcelona, yeah. Flatter to Deceive. Mark Crossass is now playing in the Mexican League. He was playing for Santos, who also play in the Hoops. I think he's changed now. I think he plays for Tigres or another team. But they don't seem to adapt very well to the physicality of Scottish football. Yeah. Hopefully, we get one.
Yeah, but South America. I mean, if you look at the players we've signed, like Rafael Scheidt, everyone remembers him. And what other South American players have we had? Juninho.
He was fucking pissed as well, man. I always remember that. That photo of him playing in Europe. I can't remember who we were playing. We were playing somewhere away in Europe. And he's like, he was talking to this big referee, and the referee was maybe 6 foot something, and he was however short he was, and he's looking up at the ref with both his hands out in a very Latin American fashion.
Yeah, I know. I think you're right. They don't always when they do take to the climate and the style of football, they're amazing to have, but they're luxury players, and I think they need a lot of time to acclimatise. So Scotland's I think it's a tall order.
Yeah. Hi, but do you mind that Dundee side when Jim Duffy was the manager, and they had I mind that player with the really long ponytail, yeah. Caballero. He was different class.
Yeah.
They had Julian Speroni in goals. Yeah. They had Caniggia who did he win a World Cup medal for Argentina? He definitely represented Argentina.
It's crazy if you think about it. And that was during the era of spending, you know, like when Rangers were signing Tori Andrew Flo, and I think it was during that era those guys were about. So
yeah, absolutely. But you know, look at what's happened to Dundee now. They've certainly paid the price for it.
We're back to Sevco again. You know, I think I've been reading some articles on where they sit financially, and it's not looking good for them. The Ibrox has become the stadium is becoming a problem for them. The press release and the way they deal with the media is terrible, and just, you know, they've made some bad signings, and it's just sitting here watching them. They'll be at this rate they'll be lucky to finish in mid table, but yeah, I'm not shedding any tears. To be quite honest, it's all self-inflicted with them, so they've only got themselves to blame. But that's good. I'm looking forward to the Aberdeen game we've got on Saturday, I believe. So that's going to be an interesting one. Obviously, we're away. It's a 12 o'clock kickoff. That's lunchtime UK, so you'll be able to see that. I might actually be able to see that as well if I stay up late enough. What do you reckon the score's going to be for that, Jonny?
I reckon it'll be tight. I think it'll be 2-1 Celtic, and we'll get a last minute goal. I mind that the last time I was at Pittodrie was I think it was 2014 or 2012, and it was a nothing game, and Charlie Mulgrew scored in the last minute. I went with one of my best pals for school, and he was studying in university, and I'd got things with my dad, so I don't usually take a drink, but I'd had a bottle of Buckfast in the morning before the match, and I was fucking steaming. I can't even remember anything of the whole game. All I remember is Mulgrew scoring in the last kick of the ball, and we were right in the corner of the stadium, right next to Aberdeen fans, and they were sort of main stand behind the goal, and there was this one big massive fat guy with curly hair that was giving a shit the whole game, and then right after they scored they all started calling him Carlos Puyol, and it was like, hey, Puyol. Absolutely brilliant. Fantastic. I think it'll be that kind of scoreline. I think it'll be tight, like just say to Sevco, yeah. Tight, and then a last minute goal, but we'll be the ones that come out on top. What about yourself? What are you feeling for the game?
I actually don't think Aberdeen are that good. I think they are, I don't think they're going to be as good as they were last season. I think we're going to run away with things quite quickly. I think we're going to win by a couple of goals. I think it's going to be like a. We're keeping clean sheets at the moment. I'm going to put us down for a 2-0. I'm going to say 2-0. Because it'll be tight, but I still think I don't think we'll be in any trouble. So I'm putting Dembele for one, and Sviatchenko. Sviatchenko's got a goal coming, man. I'm telling you.
Oh, absolutely.
He's got one
coming. One that gets allowed this time. But do you think what sort of team do you think he'll go with, like back to what one would call our first team, you know, that we played against the Huns and against, you know, European position? Or do you think he'll maybe give a few players that impressed today another chance on Saturday?
It's funny because you look at the Forest and Patrick Roberts conundrum, you know, and when Roberts played today, what I saw of him in the Ross County game was he was beating people, which that's what you want from a winger. Now James Forrest he does it in a slightly different way. James Forrest, he's not the same player, but you still get a lot of distribution from him because he can open up play and he can get past people in a different way. But personally, I still really like I like Patrick Roberts a lot. It's just a shame he's not our player. So from that angle, I'd like to see Forrest start, but I really like Patrick Roberts. He's you could see the touch, like even in the Gladbach game when he came on, and then again the Ross County game today. He's got such great technique. He's going to be a really big player if he keeps going the way he's going. So I'd like to see him come in as much as possible. But I still think we have to keep Forrest on, mainly because he's our player. We have to play him to the point where if he is going to drop form, then do it then. But don't just. So I'd play Forrest. I would keep the same team other than Bitton. For me, Bitton's finished there. I think we need to start looking past him. I think the sooner we get rid of Bitton, the better. He's a liability. He's going to start becoming a liability in Scottish games as well. I really don't rate him. I never rated him last season. I think the season before he was a good player, but he's not aware. He knocks the ball about sometimes without looking where he's putting the ball, and he's just he was starting to foul people as well. He's, you know, like making lazy tackles and getting, he's a liability. So I would have a Henderson or Armstrong and maybe McGregor. But other than that, I'd keep the team the same. I like Jozo. I think Jozo Simonovic is a really good player now. I think he's coming into the fore. So I would have him and Eric in the middle against Aberdeen. But maybe you bring in Toure because he's a big game player. It is a big game. So because we've got Gladbach again only a few days later. Basically, we're playing Aberdeen on Saturday and then we play Gladbach on Tuesday. So I reckon Colo will probably get rested for the European game and they'll put Simonovic in.
Give him his first Champions League start, be good, good yeah. Experience for him, definitely.
Yeah, I mean, and Izzy had a great game, so that was brilliant. Izzy Geary played really well today, I think, from what I saw. Again, I didn't see the whole game, but from what I can see, Izzy Geary played really well. So he might rest again, I don't know. He might rest people for the European game. I mean, if we can get a result at Gladbach, which is probably unlikely, but it does change things in the group. So who knows what Brendan's going to. He's full of surprises. He likes to tinker, does our Brendan. So we'll see what happens.
Aye, good on him. Even today as well, you know, is the subs that he made. Even, you know, I'd honestly go toe for toe for who dislikes Beaton more between yourself and me. Even, you know, today when he came on, you know, you could tell Roger told him, look, just go there, get in the centre park, steady the ship. And, you know, to a certain extent it did work. Like, every sub that Rogers makes, a lot of them are ballsy, but, you know, they're effective. They're, it's not like fucking right. Well, I don't even want to talk about last season, but you can basically tell that that he knows what he's doing, you know. And like you say, yeah, he likes to tinker, but pretty much all of his tinkerings have paid off that he's done so far.
Yeah, it's almost like everything he does it with purpose, you know. He does it with confidence. He's like, I'm making that change and I'm making it with confidence because this is what I'm going to try and do. And it might not be the exact perfect decision at that time, but the fact that he's bold about his decisions can often catch teams out. I think, you know, like he'll suddenly drop, you know, three players in defence and bring on an extra attacker, and that is brilliant. It shows ingenuity and it shows being able to think on the fly, and that was something that we've been missing. I think Lennon would just choose the same team again and again, and Ronnie Dyler just couldn't get him fired up. So I think having a manager that can do changes when he needs to and surprise opposition is really important. So maybe he'll throw a few surprises against Gladbach away. But yeah, for the Aberdeen game, I think we'll maybe rest a few players. Maybe Patrick Roberts starts, keep Forrest for the European game or vice versa, and we'll see what happens up front. I reckon Dembele's going to get selected for... I mean, Griffiths
is still a bit hesitant. I think he showed a bit of hesitancy, maybe, you know, in the last couple of games. So Dembele is, as I said, I think he's becoming indispensable. He's becoming the kind of player that we just can't afford to drop, you know.
Yeah, it seems like for him, every game that he does is just, it builds up more of a momentum. Like even today, him getting that goal right to death was, would have done miles for his confidence. Well, not that he needs much more confidence, but like Roger says, you know, it's all about momentum, and it does seem that with every game that he plays, it gets stronger and stronger and stronger. And like you say, it's going to go on to the point where you just cannot play him.
Yeah, you know, and this is the scary thing about it. You know, look at what Brendan Rodgers has done with, you know, Dallas team. I mean, in January, if he builds again, it's going to be really interesting to see what happens next season when he starts getting the players in. He's going to change out the midfield, and he's probably going to play about with the defense a little bit more. So yeah, I mean, it's the money. We know we've got the money, so it just depends who we get in. Personally, I don't know if James McCarthy is exactly the right kind of player, but he certainly, when he's on form, he's a brilliant player, way better than anything we've got outside of Brown. So I'm looking forward to January to see who they get.
Would you strengthen a goalkeeper? We're definitely fucking sell at least one of them.
Yeah, I would.
What do you reckon to the goal?
I don't think De Vries is up for it. I mean, Gordon's, he, you know, I still think he was a wee bit guilty with his getting beat. He gets beat at the near post sometimes, like he did against Gladbach. You know, like, it's a difficult shot to save because it was low and hard at an angle, and fair enough. But Gordon's great. He is a great keeper. I just still think we need something else in there just to keep him on his toes, and De Vries isn't going to do it for whatever reason. De Vries is, if De Vries ever comes back in and has a couple of bad games, he'll never play it in a Celtic shirt again. I think the fans will just turn on, if Rodgers keeps putting him in and he keeps making mistakes, they'll turn on him. So Rodgers isn't daft. I said this before about Celtic, you know, players come up and they think that they've got a bit of time, and you really don't have that much time at Celtic. You've only got a window to prove yourself, and if you don't do it, and if you mess up in big games, you don't get second or third chances, you know. It's very difficult. So I think I would get another keeper, yeah. I would get a keeper, and I'd probably look at getting cover for Colo if he's going to leave. If Colo's going to stay, then fine. But I think midfield and defence would be priority. I don't think we need another striker. Maybe a backup, but I can't see it, really. We're only playing a one-striker system, so...
Aye, we do. I think that'd be the last part of the team that we'd need to strengthen if it was going to come to a full-on hang. I haven't got plenty of options up front.
How much do you think Dembele's worth?
What, a current form? But it depends. Like, see, you put him in the Premier League, and you're talking fucking crazy money. But it's just because he plays in the SPL, you've got to keep your feet on the ground, so to speak.
So, what do you think he's worth then? That, given that he's playing with us, what do you think we would get? If somebody came in now, what, like 15?
Well, you know, I'm a Celtic fan, so I always like to go a bit too over the top. I'd say 20 million. I know that's probably a bit that's excessive, but I think. You know, I don't even want to talk about selling them, but if they need to put an outlandish price tag on them, because I mean, you look at these fucking bang average players that go for silly money in the Premier League, that are nowhere near as capable as what Dembele's going to be.
No.
But just because they play in that league, you know, they get away with these crazy sums of money.
Even in the Championship, so as well. It's just. And this is the thing, I think they touched about Celtic Rock and Rolls, Rachel Lynch was talking about it, and she was saying that you're not going to get that sort of money for him because of where he plays. But I mean, we got a pretty penny for Virgil van Dijk, and we got decent money for Foster, and generally forwards fetch a higher price tag, so I don't see why we couldn't get close to that. But I don't want him to go. I want him to stay for 3, 4, 5 seasons. I think we'll get at least another season out of him. We'll see what happens.
Did you hear Zidane? And Zidane was getting interviewed. I think it was yesterday, the day before. No, it was after the Sevco game.
Oh, yep.
And Zidane was saying that he. You know, not that Zidane's got the most in his career, but he was saying that he thinks it's, that he should stay at Celtic for at least another season or two. That's the best club to nurture him. You know, they're a club full of history. They're a club competing in Europe. To Dembele himself, you know, he's made some pretty sound decisions for a young guy in his career. So, you know, hopefully he keeps his feet in the ground and he stays.
It's an interesting point because I think the days of us getting guys in and flinging them straight out the door is slowing down a bit. I don't think Brendan Rodgers will want that. Look, at the end of the day, everybody's got a price. Every other report you see, apparently Arsenal are waiting to buy all of our players. You know, I think Arsenal were interested in Bitton, then they were interested in Tierney, now they're interested in somebody else. And it's just like, and then they never buy them. So, you know, a lot of it is just complete nonsense from the press, and a lot of the times it's actually to try and unsettle us, you know. But yeah, I think he will get at least a season or two. I mean, he is still very young, so long may it continue, though, because the guy is phenomenal. He really is. He's a phenomenal striker. He's very quickly becoming, he's going to be the first name on the sheet for me. Him and Brown. Just fantastic. So we've got we get Aberdeen away, Gladbach away, two big games. It's another big week. Really interesting to see what's going to transpire now with the games that we've just played. We've got quite a gap is opening out between us and the rest. I mean, but says 7 points clear of Aberdeen with a game in hand. That's a 10-point buffer if we're in hand, and that's not even, you know, what are we? No, it's not even November yet. But I think we're going to run away with it. I really do. Crazy, but brilliant. You know, that's what we want, and then that's the way it should be. If you look at the resources we've got, we should be running away with the league every year. And
absolutely. And when's the cup final? Is that any time soon, or is it still a couple of weeks before that?
Because
I know that's early this year, is it?
27th of November. Yeah, cup final is on the 27th of November. I'm sitting here looking at the fixtures for Celtic. So 27th of November is a 3 o'clock kickoff, which means I'll have to get up at 4 a.m. and fucking watch that. But I'll probably be up at 4 a.m. anyway, because that's when my little girl decides to scream her head off. So that's all good. But
between her and the dogs, it sounds like you've got your hands pretty full.
Mate, my life is just one mad moment to the next, between running a business and I've got a 4-year-old who's just wants to get out and play football all the time, and my little girl, she's wild. But I wouldn't have it any other way. It's brilliant. I love it. Family mayhem. You know, it's what it's all about.
Good on you, man. Good on you.
And you must be missing your folks. When was the last time you saw your family, Jonny? You've been on the road for a while, obviously.
It's been a long time. Like, I was home for a week, and when was it? It was in February. I only saw my old man. My mum was buzzing at home, so I've not seen my mum for over a year. Yeah. But we're going to all get together this Christmas. Me, my dad, my three sisters.
Oh, nice.
We're going to. It'll be the first Christmas I've had with my family for 6 years, because from my old job, I was always away working at Christmas time.
Oh, wow.
So it's going to be really nice not to have just to have a bit of the, like you say, you know, the family mayhem. It gets a lot of stick at the time, but when you look back on it, or you look forward to it, it's always good memories with the people that are closest to you.
That's good. Yeah, it's difficult as when you're living away from home. I've been away from Scotland for a long time, and those, you know, getting together with family is massive. It's quite strange when you see them, you know, after a year, you actually see how people change. You know, it's like I see my old man and I go, "You're getting a bit older." He probably looks at me and thinks the same thing, but it's it's good. It's good. I'm going to be going back. I'm going back to Glasgow, hopefully not this Christmas, but next. So yeah, my hope is that Brendan gets us into Europe. I said this in the last one. We really want him to get us into Europe so I can go to a European game. That's my Christmas wish list for next year. But listen, it's been, I think we're probably close to wrapping up for this episode. I just wanted to do a wee Sevco and Ross County and catch up with yourself. It's been great speaking to you, mate. And where can people find you on Twitter? What's your Twitter handle? You can put that out.
My handle is Jonny with no H, so it's Jonny, Hail 67.
Cool.
Jonny Hale Hale 67.
Cool, and it's an interesting Twitter page. Lots of pictures of South America and cool. And yeah, you should any young talent, send it along. Now John Part's gone, you know, Brendan might get a finder's fee. You never know.
it depends what kind of talent you're on about, though. You know.
Well, as I said, you've got to speak to Paulie D because he's been making some terrible claims about you, what you get up to. But you know, I'd probably be doing the same.
He's an absolute head case himself. I don't need to make up any rumours about him. Everything you've heard about Jungle Jim or St. Paul, believe me, it's absolutely true.
Really? Really? This is good. This is good. I like this.
No, but.
Podcast gossip.
I think it was the Smell of Glove Cap podcast last week, the week before, that they're on about doing a failure this year and going and driving for New York.
Yeah, that was Chris. And there was, mentioned it on my podcast. There, he said that they're going to go down from New York down to Philly. Yeah, stopping off.
No, well, for it.
In New Jersey, so, I think. New Jersey as well, I think so.
Anyone listening, if you can make it, it's honestly such a good get together, and you know, like people like, you know, Chris and Paul and Dr. J and all the Celtic family, you know, you meet these people and you meet them for a minute and it's like you've been pals for years and like I said at the start of the podcast, it's honestly probably one of the only things in life that you can connect to people in that way.
Yeah.
I'd urge everybody I know, all my pals. Yeah. To if they can share that experience, because it's absolutely brilliant.
No, right on. I mean, look, this is what it's all about. This is why we all love Celtic. This is why we all, you know, whether you've, you know, found Celtic in the last 5 years or whether you've been following them since you were, you know, dropped out of the womb, it doesn't really matter. You know, you see someone wearing the top, you say hail, hail, and straight away you know that if you need help, you're going to get help, you know, no matter where you are in the world, you know. Do you need a lift somewhere? Do you need somewhere to stay? And that's it, you know, we look after each other and it's just a brilliant thing. But I'd love to go to that. As I said, I'm talking to the missus. I think it will involve a vast shopping spree in New York, but that's
I believe me, it's a bullet well worth taking if you get to go along.
Oh, it'd be magic. I was legendary. I used to listen to Beyond the Waves and all those guys talking about it, and just it was like, wow, you know. I actually remember they did a couple of podcasts live from one of them, and it just sounded brilliant. Kind of thing that I'd love. So yeah, maybe I'll see you at one of those in the future. Who knows?
Hopefully, but honestly, it's been an absolute privilege being on the podcast. Thank you very much for having me on.
Oh, not at all, mate. Not at all. It's been a pleasure getting you on, and as I said, it's always a great interest for me to get people on that are far flung corners of the world. That's what my podcast is more geared towards, is getting in touch with Tims that are, you know, out there travelling, and certainly you're on your intrepid adventures, mate. So we'll keep in touch, and we'll definitely do it again.
Absolutely, yeah, brilliant. Thank you very much.
All good, mate. Well, take care of yourselves on your travels, mate. Hail, hail.
Yeah, hail, hail. You know, all the best. Have a good time over New Zealand. I hope you don't get too much grief off the wolves that you've got in your garden.
Oh, no. They've been fed raw meat and subdued, so they'll be fine.
All right, all the best, pal. Hail, hail.
Hail, hail.
is real.